What you're seeing on screen is the source code to Hello.c, the Hello World application for Windows 1.0 written over 35 years ago. Hello World programs are simple test applications that programmers frequently write as a way to demonstrate programming environments and test that their tools are working. The original Windows Hello program is thus notable for its unusually long length. Most Hello programs, as we will see, are only a few lines of code at maximum. Furthermore, it's also notable because it's the first example code most people coding for this ancient version of Windows would have seen. As such, it begs the question, what did software development look like on these ancient versions of Windows? The first step was installing IBM PC DOS 3.3. Using the fdisk command, I created two partitions. The first is what's known as the primary partition, which would hold DOS and Windows and form my C drive. The second partition, which I ultimately ended up not using, was created to hold data and other project files. With my hard drives partitioned and then formatted, it was time to finish setup. That job lies with the select utility, a name where IBM's influence over early DOS development truly shows. With that complete, I ejected the setup disk and rebooted the virtual machine. We are already done with step one. While I start getting the Windows 1.0 disks in, I would appreciate it all if you could leave a like and subscribe, since it really does mean a lot to me and the channel. Anyway, continuing on, Windows setup is extremely straightforward in comparison and provides simple selections asking for our keyboard layout, display type, and mouse type. While we have a US compatible keyboard and our video card is capable of using EGA, what we don't have is a compatible mouse. Windows 1.0 predates the existence of the computer mouse as a standard piece of computer hardware. Unfortunately, to complicate matters, I don't have the ability to emulate a serial or bus mouse that Windows 1.0 natively supports. I do, however, have a plan B. First, though, I want to ensure that we can simply get up and running. After answering all the questions and feeding the disks, we're ready to start Windows 1.0 and... So apparently, I made a typo the first time through the installer, which caused that interesting bit of screen graffiti. Having solved the initial problem by reinstalling and selecting the correct option off-screen, it was now time to solve the issue of no mouse support. Windows 2.0 did support the now ubiquitous PS2-style mouse, and is similar enough to 1.0 that its drivers can be used. However, annoyingly, Windows 1.0 must be reinstalled to be reconfigured. To use the updated driver, we must take mouse.drv from the Windows 2.0 install floppies, copy it onto disk 1 of the 1.0 floppies, and then selecting bus mouse in the setup screen. After refeeding all the disks, I can indeed report success. I have working mouse support in Windows 1.0. Now having Windows fully set up, it was time to figure out how to set up a development environment. Unfortunately, there is virtually no online documentation how to do this, but the excellent OS2 Museum has scanned copies of some of the original reference binders. Secondly, on closer examination of the disks, I found an installation batch file and a README file on the second disk. To summarize, Microsoft supported the following environments for Windows 1.0 development. Microsoft C Compiler version 4, not to be confused with Visual C++ 4. Microsoft Pascal Compiler 3.3 or later, or Microsoft's Macro Assembler 4.0. Finding Microsoft C 4.0 wasn't hard, but once again, I had to go reading through scans of manuals to figure out how to set it up properly. As hard drives were not common at the time, Microsoft supported running the compiler both from floppy disk or installation onto a hard disk. Hard disk installation requires manually creating and copying executables, libraries, headers, from each disk, as well as editing config.sys and autoexec.bat. It was at this point I also installed SLED, a free full-screen text editor, as DOS 3.3 had only shipped with Edlin, a line editor that is difficult to use. Edit, on the other hand, would not come until DOS 5. With the compiler sorted, I wrote a quick Hello World program to smoke test it. With that hurdle solved, it was on to the next step, the Windows SDK. Compared to setting up the compiler, this was relatively straightforward. The first step was to copy the installation script to the C drive. This prompted inserting 4 of the 7 SDK disks and installed several utilities to the hard drive. I decided to relaunch Windows and give these tools a quick once-over. The first up is Dialog, a graphical editor used for editing user interfaces, something that would evolve into the Resource Editor in later Microsoft development tools. Next up is the aptly named Font Edit and Icon Edit, which, as its name implies, allows you to edit fonts and icons, respectively. Following that is Slap Junior, which is a screenshot-taking application. And finally, last but not least, is Shaker and Heapwalk. Shaker, as the name may suggest, rearranges data in memory, essentially fuzz testing to see if an application will crash. Its companion application, Heapwalk, allows the global heap to be examined for leaked or lost objects and handles. In modern day terms, these can be considered similar to Valgrind and Microsoft's compatibility validation tools, both which help shake loose and dislodge programming bugs. Moving on to the remaining three disks of the software development kit, the fifth disk contained debug builds of the Windows kernel. The remaining two disks had sample programming code, including the infamous Hello World sample. Compared to modern Windows programming, it's easy to see where the kernel of the modern Win32 API comes from, encrusted with the more painful aspects of coding for real mode. I've put in a noted copy of it up on GitHub that explains these details for those who are interested. The link is in the description. Having gotten the SDK installed and the sample code loaded, the next step was getting it to compile. To this end, Microsoft have provided the make command, which helps manage source compilation. Unfortunately, trying to compile within Windows itself simply failed with an out-of-core message, requiring me to quit to DOS. However, on the second try, I successfully managed to build a working hello.exe. Needless to say, mission accomplished. Since I was here, though, I figured it was worth taking a look a little deeper. Going through the disks, I copied a few of the more interesting programs over to the hard drive, although I found using the Windows 1.0 UI more difficult than I'd like for this task. In the end, besides Hello, I also grabbed Font Test and Card File. The former, as the name suggests, is a test of Windows font capabilities, which perhaps unsurprising, were extremely limited at the time. Cardfile, on the other hand, is a simple digital Rolodex and is one of the programs that shipped out of the box on Windows 1.0 and remained a core program until Windows for Workgroups. Now that we've explored the Windows 1.0 SDK, it was time to put Windows backwards compatibility to the test. The first stop was Windows 3.11, the last major release of 16-bit Windows. A new virtual machine was spun up and Microsoft DOS 6 was installed, followed by Windows itself. It's a little known fact these days, but early Windows actually had a pretty low level of forward compatibility. Microsoft even went as far as to drop support for Windows 1.0 and 2.0 binaries in Windows 95 and later. At this point, we have jumped 8 years ahead from 1985 to 1993, shortly before the world began moving en masse to 32-bit computing. With our applications copied to a floppy disk, Windows 3.1 did not disappoint, throwing up a large compatibility warning on screen nearly immediately. However, accepting the warning showed that all three applications ran successfully, albeit with a fixed space font and an unusually small loading window. In my research, I discovered that there's a special utility that shipped as part of the Windows 3.1 SDK known as Mark. Mark, as the name suggests, allows developers to mark their binaries compatible with 3.1. and it was intended to allow developers to support multiple versions of Windows at once. Making a test copy of our binaries, I then marked them from the command line. Once marked, no warning showed up regarding backwards compatibility, and it also enabled the use of TrueType fonts as seen on the font test and in the About dialog of Hello. The next test was, could we go further? Windows NT, which is the direct ancestor of modern Windows, could in fact run Windows 1.0 and 2.0 binaries through the use of the NT Virtual DOS mode, or NTVDM. NTVDM combined with Windows on Windows, or WoW, provide compatibility for legacy DOS and 16-bit Windows on the NT series of Windows. This is different from the Windows 95, 98, and Millennium Edition. NTVDM is still a component of Windows 10 today, however, there are complications. The move to 64-bit, among other things, dropped legacy 16-bit support entirely from Windows and does not include NTVDM.
Nearly any computer from the last decade would likely have a 64-bit version of Windows pre-installed. That being said, Microsoft still makes a 32-bit version of Windows 10 available. That 32-bit version of Windows still includes NTVDM. As such, I grabbed the 1909 version of Windows, installed it into a VM, and then inserted the disk with our applications. Double-clicking Hello prompted Windows to download and install NTVDM, a promising first step. On the second try, I can in fact confirm it's possible. 35 years of backwards compatibility. Font test also worked, although the TrueType fonts from Windows 3.1 have disappeared over the decades. However, card file errors out. I did do some basic debugging with WinDebug and isolated it as an initialization error. However, the full story of card file will have to wait for another day. I hope you enjoyed this look into computer history. I have a Discord server available where this and other retro computing projects are talked about, or feel free to hit me up on Twitter. If you have a topic you're interested in hearing about, drop me a line and I might do a video on it. If you enjoyed this content, please like and subscribe. Until the next time, this is NCommander signing out.